Hey family, today we're going to continue our discussion about the FIRE movement. So in previous episode, the FIRE movement is financial independence doable for late bloomers, part one. We accomplished a few things. We determined the normal retirement age based on the rules around Social Security benefits. I provided three definitions of financial independence. We discussed Robert Kiyosaki's cash flow quadrant. I provided three tips to help late bloomers gain financial independence. And I provided a list of resources to help you educate yourself on the road to achieving FIRE, which stands for Financial Independence Retire Early. If you missed part one, be sure to check it out. For part two of the series, I'm going to provide some more tips in a more personal way by sharing with you what I've accomplished on my road to financial independence and how fast results were achieved with limited resources. You don't want to miss this episode. Before we get into today's juicy content, be sure to like this video, subscribe to my channel, and hit the alert button to be aware of new content as soon as it is released. I'm bringing you fresh content each and every month, and today is no exception. Now on to today's inspirational episode. After I graduated college, I had a decent job making decent money, but my expenses and loan repayments basically ran neck and neck with my income. As my cash inflows increased over the years and my cash outflows continued to run neck and neck with my earnings, I never felt like I was middle class. I had a big house in the suburbs, but I still felt poor. Whether you are financially independent or on your journey towards financial independence, my advice is the same. Tip number one, be faithful with what you have. Don't try going after more when you haven't been faithful with what you have. There are several verses in the Bible that talk about being faithful with small things. Here are a few. So Luke 16:10 says, "One who is faithful in very little is also faithful in much, and one who is dishonest in very little is also dishonest in much." Matthew 25:29 says, "For to everyone who has will more be given, and he will have an abundance. But from the one who has not, even what he has will be taken away." Matthew 25:21 says, "His master said to him, 'Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a little. I will set you over much. Enter into the joy of your master.'" When I landed my first job out of college, I thought being faithful with my money meant tithing, giving to charity, and paying my bills on time. But there are higher levels of faithfulness that come with money mastery. Money mastery is when your money is working for you so that you don't have to work. There are different levels of money mastery that require different levels of faith. When I was in college, I learned about being faithful in my giving and with paying bills, but I knew very little about money mastery. I was in money's debt and in money's service. I doubled my income and then doubled it again, but I was still struggling to make ends meet, which leads me to tip number two. Make one of your financial goals to increase your net cash flow each year. In 2006, I began to educate myself on how to better manage my finances. I wasn't thinking about how to be financially independent and retire early. Back then, my goal was to increase my net cash flow by reducing my expenses and becoming debt-free. Net cash flow is the difference between your cash inflow and your cash outflows. You got cash coming in and cash going out. If those amounts are roughly the same, then you won't have the cash you need to build a better financial future, and you aren't mastering your money.
Most people will try to increase their net cash flow by increasing their income. They'll take a better paying job, work overtime more often, get a second job, or take on a few side hustles. However, if your income has been steadily increasing over the past 10, 15, 20 years, and you don't have any savings, and you don't have less debt and expenses than you did 10, 15, 20 years ago, then earning more money won't change anything for you. Whatever you earn, you'll spend like clockwork. Most often, the answer to your money problems isn't more money. Let me repeat that. Most often, the answer to your money problems isn't more money. It's less expenses, less debt, and more savings. Tip number two has revolutionized my life because it is a no-fail system. When your net cash flow steadily increases each year, that signals to the universe that you are in control of your finances, and the universe will reward you with more cash. For to everyone who has, will more be given, and he will have an abundance. I want to rework that verse a little bit by saying, for to everyone who has more net cash flow each year, will more be given, and he will have an abundance of cash. In 2008, I left my job in the workforce to homeschool my son. I homeschooled him from preschool through high school, and you can learn more about that journey in my book, Training Sons, Raising Men. During that time, our household cash inflows decreased by half, but our net cash flow and savings steadily increase, not by hundreds, but by thousands of dollars. By 2011, we were debt free, and I didn't use debt again until around 2015. Tip number three, if you want to get out of debt, stop using debt. Visually, you can see maybe in your mind that if you are in a hole and you want to get out, you should stop digging deeper. Between 2007 and 2014, I didn't use debt. I stopped digging deeper. I cut up my credit cards, closed those accounts, and paid off everyone I owed. Tip number four, being debt-free is a state of mind. The day I decided that I did not need credit is truly the day that I became debt-free. I was mentally free and emotionally free from using credit to build my esteem. A certain amount of education and training are required to know how to use debt to build wealth. If you use debt just to buy stuff, then you really aren't using debt responsibly. Stuff doesn't build wealth. Income producing assets build wealth. Probably 10% of people know how to use debt to build wealth. I currently have debt, but I'm debt free, and you can be debt free as well. Let me explain what being debt free presently looks like for me. I have three credit cards, credit card A, B, and C. Credit card A earns points that convert to cash. I use this card to earn points and to get paid, and it gets paid off at the end of each month. Credit card B is a business credit card. I use this card to build business credit, and it gets paid off at the end of each month. Credit card C has the lowest interest rate, and I seldom use this card. I got this card to increase my credit limit. If and when I use it, it will get paid off at the end of the month. Basically, I don't have any credit card debt, and I don't have any loans. I paid off my car the year after I purchased it. All my student loans are paid in full. The only debt I have is my mortgage on my primary residence. My home is an income-producing asset because I have a paying tenant. So if you're going to use debt, learn how to use it to purchase income-producing assets. Tip number five, use extra cash to build wealth. Some of you are saying, extra cash? What extra cash? I don't have extra cash. Remember, your goal is to increase your net cash flow each year. That increase is equivalent to extra cash. If you are normally strapped for cash, then extra cash doesn't feel like it's extra, even though it is. Remember those stimulus checks? That's what I call extra cash. Tax refunds, bonus checks, salary wage increases, cash gifts received at birthdays, holidays, or whenever, cash from side hustles, overtime, second jobs, dividend and interest, extra paychecks if you are paid every other week. Twice a year, you get paid three times in 1 month instead of twice a month. I consider that third payment extra cash. And also savings from what you would have spent. So I'm explaining that last one a little more in just a moment. But first, I want to give you my personal testimony about how I have treated extra cash. I will splurge a little with extra cash, but the majority will get invested. 10% of my tax refund will go to charity. I'll splurge $100 to $200 and the rest will go into savings or get invested. My past two salary increases went directly to my 401k. Each subsequent increase will either go to my 401k or get invested in some way so that I'm using my extra money to build wealth. The rent that I receive from my tenant goes directly to buying investments. And the dividends and interest I receive on investments get reinvested. Now let's talk about the last bullet point, savings from what you would have spent. So I went to get an oil change and I had a $10 coupon, so I saved $10. Other ways that we feel like we're saving is like, you know how you go to the grocery store and you'll look at the receipt, maybe at the bottom it says you saved $8.50. Maybe you're avoiding certain bank fees because your paycheck is directly deposited into your checking account, or by keeping a certain balance on your account. We consider that, hey, I've saved, say, the $7 they would have charged me. So you and I know that whatever we save, we actually spend it somewhere else. So, you know, if it's 50% off, then you think, hey, well, that 50% I would have paid, I'll spend it. Now I can buy another pair of shoes or something like that. But that's not savings in the pure sense of the word. It's spending. So I thought to myself, what if we actually turned our savings into real savings by putting whatever we save through, say, discounts, coupons, rebates into a savings account or invested it? I think this approach is a good idea because we could begin to quantify our efforts to bargain shop. So let's say in 1 year you were able to save $300 when shopping, and all that money went into your savings account. A few hundred dollars is enough to inspire me to hunt for bargains. Right now we're in inflationary times and there are no real bargains. Even if there's a $10 off sale, the item might have normally been $20 less anyway. So you're not technically saving. However, when prices normalize, or if what seems to be, or something seems to be a bargain, and it really is a bargain, I'm going to start saving my savings, starting with that $10 off coupon I use for the oil change. At the end of the year, I'll let you know how much I really saved. So I'm gonna try this tip, and I've given you 5 tips to achieve financial independence. And now I wanna provide additional inspiration to fuel your financial transformation. When I started my debt-free journey, I didn't feel like I was earning enough nor paying back enough to have a significant impact on my debt balance. I was heading towards bankruptcy with a mountain of debt, so I was definitely feeling like the underdog with no advantages to speak of. I knew the road ahead of me might be long and difficult to navigate, but I was determined to start my journey towards better. Family, please listen to what I'm saying. Do not allow your perceived inadequacies to dissuade you from doing the right thing. Financial independence is the right target for late bloomers to attain, even if it does not lead to early retirement. Yes, I would like to retire before I'm 67 years old. As quickly as possible, I want to leave the E quadrant and earn my money strictly in I and B quadrants. If you are in your 50s, your 40s or 50s, financial independence is doable by the time you reach retirement age or sooner. Achieving financial independence is the right target for you to have if you want to improve your quality of life in the short term, live comfortably in retirement, gain and exercise more financial wisdom, leave a sizable inheritance to those you love, and or retire early. Do not be overwhelmed or discouraged by your starting point. Just get started. If you've been on the financial independence journey for a few years now, don't stop. Don't give up. Consider the alternatives to financial independence. You're living the alternative. And though many things about your life might have improved since you started gaining and exercising more financial wisdom, you know there's a lot more to learn and to do. So keep going. You can do it. On the next episode of Danielle Inspires, I'm going to talk about how to pay off your mortgage early. If you don't own a home but want to buy a house in the future, we're going to discuss steps you should take to buy your first home. Until then, be bold, be great, and be inspired. Talk to you soon.
Thank you for joining me for another episode of Danielle Inspires. If you haven't done so already, be sure to like this video, subscribe to my channel, hit the alert button so you are aware of new content as soon as it is released, and share this video with those you love. See you soon.